Let me tell you this while you're going along. We're the Vision at Christ Point Church. We're real people. We're living real lives, and we're serving a real God. We want to connect real people with real relationships, with real individuals going through real issues. You know, we're kidding ourselves if we're hiding ourselves in a bubble if we don't have issues. So we want to hit them head on, and we want to get out in front of the game. And you know what? We want to invite people to a place where they can meet a real God. So that's our mission. That's our vision statement. Radio listeners, good to have you guys with us this morning. TV, YouTube, it's good to have everybody linking up with us, and we want to say welcome home. It's good to have you with us. Let's make a deal. Week two. Now we're going to go. If you haven't figured this out, we're going to be 4 weeks. You might have figured that out, but if you're listening to me on radio, we have 4 cards on the board. But this is week two. Let's make a deal. We're going to flip a card here in just a few minutes. But I'm going to kind of subtitle this: Stop Me If You Know All This. Stop me if you know all of this. And I got to tell you a quick story, real quick. I dreamed about 5 o'clock this morning that I was not prepared, and that everything was falling apart on stage, and I was a nervous wreck. So I'm laughing about that. So it's kind of funny. But anyway, stop me if you know all this. Now, let me tell you, I got to set this up. A man was riding his motorcycle. And you know I love to talk about Bubba. A man was riding his motorcycle, and it was cold outside, and he had his leather jacket on, and some of us know exactly what that's like. You get that cold air hitting you around your chest, and his zipper was broken, and he couldn't get that thing zipped up, so he finally just pulled over. It was getting cooler and cooler and cooler. Some of us have been there. He got off his bike, turned his jacket around backward, put his arms in it, and then he continues to ride. It's protecting his chest. He's not freezing to death now. So the next thing he does, he goes down, hits a curve, don't negotiate the curve correctly, and has a motorcycle accident right in front of Bubba's house. Bubba goes down. Stop me if you know all this, by the way. Bubba goes down there. Bubba calls 911 and says, we got a guy on a motorcycle accident here. And they said, first thing they said, is there any signs of life? Bubba says, well, there was until I turned his head back around, right? Stop me if you know all this. Murph was out riding his motorcycle one day, and he ran out of gas right next to the hospital. Right next to the hospital. So Murph's thinking, you know what? I don't have anything on this bike that I can put any gas in. So he walks over to the hospital. And he says, can I borrow one of, a can or a canister or anything I can put gas in? They looked and they looked and looked, and all they had to provide him with was a bedpan. He said, that'll work. That'll get me home. So he walks down to the service station. He gets gas, carries gas back in his, stop me if you know this. And he's pouring gas in, and a little boy and his dad's driving by. And the little boy says, Daddy, what's that guy doing? He said, I don't know, but he sure has got a lot of faith. Stop me if you know all this. It's week two. Let's make a deal. It's also the first week in August. That means if you're a school teacher, you know what it's like to persevere, because you're just now getting. If you want to know what's, and by the way, today's topic on our character assessment for ourselves, card number two is to persevere. So if you're a teacher, by the time fall break comes, you know what it's like to persevere. You want to quit. You don't even want to see the rest of the year out. And you've got a room full of fourth graders that just love you to death. They throw up on you. They get sick on you. They don't know how to clean themselves half the time. You have to baby them. But you know what? They're just excited to see you. And by the time fall break comes, if you're a teacher, you're ready to graduate fourth graders. So a teacher knows what it's like to persevere. Today, we're going to look at perseverance. We're going to look at that one little word to persevere. Let's flip the next card. Let's look at it this morning. Let's take a look at Job. We looked at Jacob, now we're looking at Job. So you might see a common theme going on here, and you might be trying to figure out what next week's going to be. But as we flip that card, let's look at Job. And I was telling these guys back here that I was listening to a podcast, and the guy says, you know, today's society, he said, people just are a little bit more shy of the word in their life. And they just don't have they just don't read it as much as they used to. And you know, there's too many other things vying for their time. And he said, if I mention the book of Job, they think it's about an an Apple product. They think I'm going to talk about Steve Jobs. But anyway, it's not that. Let's look at Job chapter 1, verse 1. Let's look at the oldest book in the Bible. And let's just look at what it means for our lives to persevere through whatever. There was a man in the land of Uz, or some may say Uz, whose name was Job, and that man was blameless. He was upright. He feared God, and he turned away from evil. Let's look at Job's attributes. Let's look at the character that it takes to walk with the Lord. Job was blameless. All in one sentence, it tells us exactly all about this guy. I'm telling you, if people sum us up in one sentence like this, then amen. So Job was blameless. He was upright. He feared God, and he turned away from evil. These are the four things in one quick sentence. Job was also, and I'm going to run through this because there is no way to break this down quickly, scenario of Job. So I'm going to do it real fast, and I want you to go home and read it and catch up. So Job was very prosperous. God had blessed him tremendously. He was very wealthy. He had a lot of children. That was another sign of prosperity, of God's hand upon you. He had 10 children, and 7 of those were sons, and 3 of those were daughters. And it's the word says in verse 5 is a key verse in this entire book. He would intercede, basically, what we would call today intercede. He would make burnt offerings for his family every day. So let's look at verse 5. And when the days of the feast had run their course, Job would send and consecrate them. And he would rise early in the morning and offer burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, "It may be that my children have sinned and curse God in their hearts." Thus Job did this continuously. So he would intercede. He did this continually. He did this every day and without fail. Satan comes along. Now everything, God is blessing him like crazy. He is the example. If you had a dictionary in the days of Job and you looked in the dictionary as faithfulness or as a servant of the Lord, Job's picture would be there. And God was like, "Man, I'm proud of my servant." And Satan says, "Take away all that stuff and he's not going to serve you." How many of us would be able to fit into that category of take everything away from them, see if they don't curse you and die? See if they don't walk away from you? So this is what Satan does. He comes along and he attacks Job. There's a lot going on here. I'm just going to throw it out there like this. He attacks Job's family, all 10 of his children. He attacks Job's belongings, his wealth, servants, except for 4. And all of this, he destroys all of it. He kills all of the children, takes away all the belongings, takes away all the wealth, all in one day. All in one day. In one day, Job is not secure anymore. In one day, Job is not at peace anymore. In one day, Job does not have wealth anymore. In one day, Job does not have posterity. He does not have his children. He don't have any hope. So in one day, all is gone. So Job does one thing. Stop me if you know all this. Job does one thing, and it's in verse 20 and 21. Namely in verse 20, but we're going to read 21. Job rose and tore his robe, and he shaved his head, and this is key. He fell on the ground, and he worshiped the Lord. And he said, "Naked I come into this world from my mama's womb, and naked I'm going to get out of here. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." This is what Job said. I had a friend of mine that whose daughter was killed in a car accident, and he stood by her body to identify her, and he quoted this very verse right here. He said, "The Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." How faithful are we? How faithful are we? Now, this is what Job did. He worshiped. Now, it would have been easy just to fuss, cry, get upset, blame God, but he worshiped. Let's look at what he says, what it says in verse 22. In verse 22, he says, "In all this, Job did not sin or charge God with any wrong." In all of this, he didn't make any sins. He didn't charge the Lord for any wrong. Then Satan struck him again. Now see this, it wasn't good enough the first time. I can't break through this shell of faithfulness, this shell of perseverance that he has on him. I can't break through it. So I tell you what I'm going to do. Taking his children didn't faze him. Taking his wealth didn't faze him. Taking his future didn't faze him. You know what? I'm going to hit him where it hurts. I'm going to hit him in his health. So bang, he hits him in his health. And he hits him so hard that he's literally can't even sit without sitting in pain. It literally says that they sat for a week at one point, never even spoke a word because he was in such pain, and he would scrape the balls with pieces of clay pottery. So he would scratch the balls and he was in such pain. And let's look at chapter 2 and verse 9, and let's look at what his wife says. Man, everybody needs a wife like this. Then his wife says to him, "Do you still hold fast your integrity? Won't you just curse God and die?" Man, wife, I needed more out of you than that. I needed something better than that. I needed you to say, "I'm interceding with you. I'm going to fight for you." Not just curse God and die. You know, you kind of wonder, does she have somebody else on the side or what? Man, she just like, you know, call it done. In verse 10, if we look in verse 10, he says to her, "Why do you speak as one who's foolish, woman? Should we receive good from the Lord and not receive anything else, not receive evil?" In all this, Job didn't sin with his lips. He didn't sin. He didn't make any sins against the Lord. So in all of this, Job becomes is an example of us of perseverance. He's an example to us of faithfulness. He's example to us that you can, no matter what, you can stand fast in the Lord. But you know what? Job becomes depressed, and who wouldn't blame him? If you read it, he becomes depressed, and he even says, I just wish I'd never been born. It would have been better if I'd have never been born than to go through this, but I'm still not going to blame the Lord. I'm still not going to curse the Lord. I'm still not going to back up on my faithfulness. It'd just been better if I'd never been born. So he gets in a distressed state of mind, and then it always gets better when friends come along. Then three friends come along. Stop me if you know all this. Then three friends come along, and it don't even get any better. This is basically, it goes on for chapter, friend, Job. Friend, Job, Job, friend, 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 Job. So we get a lot of, you know what, and if you just kind of pull out and you see what they're saying here, Job, you must have sinned before God somewhere. God would not turn his back on you if you had not sinned against him. Job, you've got to have done something wrong. Something's got to be amiss here. And Job cries out in his state of depression, and he's just so depressed, and his friends spend several chapters basically building their case that Job's done something wrong. You know what? It's like that old saying, that old joke where you know, you tell the guy he looks bad at work at 7 o'clock in the morning, and just to mess with him, and by 3 o'clock in the evening, he's checking out and going home and won't come back for 2 or 3 days because you've convinced him in his mind that he looks bad and that he's got something wrong with him. These guys are trying to build a case against Job through several chapters. We're building a case against you. Who are the voices today telling each of us to give up? Who are the voices today telling those of us to give up? You know, because I'm going to tell you, it's probably going to look like friends. It's probably going to look like somebody we may have trusted. You know what? I didn't need somebody to come in and tell me that I'm doing wrong. I needed somebody to come in and tell me I'm going to pray for you. I didn't need somebody to tell me that build a case against me. Job has lost everything, including his health, yet he perseveres in the Lord. He stays focused on the Lord. Job remains faithful to God, and he defends God, and he defends himself. So this is my question in this sermon today. How is it that a person can know if they are totally blameless before the Lord? How is it? How do you know that you have not committed something against the Lord? How do you know that you can say in the toughest of times and the best of times, I have not sinned against the Lord? I have remained steadfast. Or let's just say this. How can anybody say with the utmost assurity that I have cultivated my walk with the Lord no matter what? I have built a relationship with the Lord, and I have cultivated that in with passion. And I have not faltered from that. How can we say that? I think we can find the answer in verse 5 if we go back to chapter 1 in verse 5. And here's where the answer lies. At the very end, it says, thus Job did this continually. This is how we know that we have a... This is how we know that if we have veered from our path, this is how we know that if we haven't cultivated that relationship accurately, because we know if we've been spending time with Him. He did this continuously. Because I'm going to tell you what, if you come up to me and you say Tina broke her arm, I'm going to believe you. Well, I think. But if you come up to me and say Tina's having an affair, I'm going to laugh at you. Because I'm going to say, now you tell me how she's doing that when I'm with her 24/7. I think I'd know. So the thing is you know, you know, Tina's like, you don't know. But I think I'm going to know. The closer I am to somebody, the more I know their voice. The closer I am to the Lord, the more I know His voice. Thus Job did continuously. Every morning he spent time with his relationship with the Lord. He spent that time. Prayer, seek the Lord, pray every day. Job knew because he spent countless hours with God. That's how we know. Now we've got this scenario where Job has become depressed. Satan's been in the picture. Job's been attacked. Job's got depressed. He's talked. The wife has talked. She didn't do too good. The friends have come along. They haven't done too good. Another friend comes along and he just rebukes everybody. And nothing's going too good. And everybody's got an opinion. See, stop me if you know all this. Everybody's got an opinion. Everybody can tell you why you're not prospering, but nobody can get in there and help you do it. Everybody can tell you why. Here's what's wrong with you. This is why you're not growing in the Lord, but nobody jump in there and help you walk with the Lord and show you how to do it. But see, everybody's got an opinion. Then all of a sudden in chapter 38, God says, I got an opinion. God comes in with His opinion. He says, He starts it out like this. Where were you? If you want to say all these things, where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Now, where were you? If you seem to know all these things, where were you then? Now, where were you when I stretched out a line and said, you know, the darkness and the light can only go this far, the sea can only go this far? Where were you when I designed the foundations of the earth? Where were you? Who shut up the seas? Who gave its boundaries? And he says all this, and this is where I'm coming to in verse 18. Have you comprehended the expanse of the earth? Declare if you know all this. You know, if this was being written in Southern Bible Belt Tennessee today, in 2018, you know what it'd say? Stop me if you know all this. God says, hey, wait a minute, stop me if you know all this, because all y'all seem to know about how I need to do things. All you guys seem to know that everything about Job, Job's all must have something wrong with him. So let me just tell you how it is. Stop me if you know how to build the earth. Stop me if you know how to forgive the sins of mankind. Stop me if you know how to restore broken relationships. Stop me if you know how to strategically and instantly move on somebody and watch the demons and of addiction fall off them. Stop me if you know how to forgive. Stop me if you can do these things. Stop me if you know all these things. I love that. Well, you know what? I'm gonna be honest with you. It never stood out to me until this week when that one verse stood out to me. Stop me if you know all this. I'll quit. I'll quit. But he didn't. Nobody can say, Lord, I know everything, and you don't. Some of us want to. But the next time we want to complain, now I want you to go with me here. The next time we want to complain, God doesn't understand. That one drives me crazy. But God doesn't understand. What makes you think God don't understand? God understands. God understands everything. God doesn't understand what it's like to be me. Yes, He does. God doesn't. When the next time we want to complain and say God doesn't understand, or it's all God's fault. You know, I think when people tell me this, well, they're blaming God. It's okay. At least they got a line of communication with God going on. God's shoulders are big. Let them fuss with God. Let them argue with God, because it's going to be healthy for them. Because if you're arguing with God, then you're going to be listening to Him a little bit. It's better than just ignoring him and walking away. But the next time we want to get into these areas of blaming God, and the next time we want to remember the seven churches in the book of Revelation. Remember the seven churches in the book of Revelation. And I just want to tell you, God says different things to all seven churches. But there's one thing he says to every one of them. Every one of them has the very same thing in common. And he says, basically, if you can hear what I'm saying, then you need to listen. Let he who has an ear hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying, or the Spirit is saying to the churches. So this is the way I break that down. If you can listen, if you have the ability to listen, then you need to pay attention. If you can hear me, then you need to listen, because then he goes on and he says, victory comes through God. It doesn't come through your three friends telling you everything you did wrong. It doesn't come through your own analysis of how to do your life. If you've got an ear and if you can hear what I'm saying, then you need to listen. You need to pay attention, because when I'm speaking, victory comes through God. That's where it comes from. It don't come from the good that I've done. It don't come from the good intentions. You know, oh yeah, well, it's better to have a great name than great, or a good name than great riches. Yeah, you can have a good name, cultivate that, but that's not going to bring victory. That's going to help you have peace, but it's the victory comes through the Lord. He even says to the book of Ephesus, he says twice, persevere. I like this about you. You persevere. If you persevere through hardships, through hard times, my buddy Johnny Hood is persevering through hard times right now. Right now. He is persevering through hard times, because I'm going to tell you, I've been there. And there's nothing worse than sitting watching your father die. And I've been there. And you know what? He's persevering through hard times right now. He don't need us to tell him that he's done everything in the world wrong. I'll aggravate him about that anyway. He needs us to say, you know what? You're a faithful man of God. And no matter what, we're not going to live forever. Our family's not going to live forever. And I want to make sure that you are on board with God. And I think you are. And you are a man of God. And that's awesome. And that's where we want to be. I want to be like you. See, there's a breakthrough though. And the breakthrough comes at the end of the perseverance. It comes at the end. Let's look at Job chapter 42. God has been speaking. We spend most of the book of Job looking at what somebody else has got to say. We spend most of the book of Job looking at guys, looking at wives, looking at Job, looking at Satan. We spend most of that time. And now God comes on the scene in chapter 38. And now in verse 42, this is what he does. He rebukes his friends. God just, he goes on with this narrative and a powerful narrative and says, look, I made that animal and I made that animal and could you even pierce his scales? Blah, blah, blah. He goes on like this. I mean, no disrespect there, but he goes on. And then he says, now let's talk about you. Now, therefore, you've got some issues. I'm rebuking you guys because you attacked my servant Job. Now, therefore, take seven bulls and seven rams and go to my servant Job. Now, this is what he's telling these guys. You get yourselves together. You get your sacrifice together and you get it over to Job. And my servant Job shall pray for you. And I will accept his prayer not to deal with you according to your folly. So all of a sudden, we've got these guys a mite nervous at the fact that we have spent days trying to convince Job that he did something wrong. Now our futures and our blessings depend on Job asking the Lord to forgive us. Let's go back to that real quick, Gwen. And this is what he says. He says, I will accept his prayer not to deal with you according to folly, for you have not spoken of me what is right as my servant Job has, but my servant Job has, see. So, make a sacrifice. Let's just call that today. See, God's not calling us today to go out in somebody's field, jack up five or six of their, seven of their cows, and start burning them at the edge of the fence row. He's not calling us to do that. This is what God's calling us to do today. Get yourselves in a humble position before the Lord. And I need you to be interceding for somebody. Because if you've spoke wrong against them, then I need you to humble yourselves before them and before me, and let's get this right. I'm commanding you to do this. And I will, my servant Job will pray for you. See, here's the thing. God's saying, you spoke against Tina. Let's just say Tina, because everybody does. You spoke against Tina. Now I want you to humble yourself. I want you to go to her. I want you to spend some time and humble yourself before, and I want her to pray for you, and I'm going to answer her prayer. But it's not because of who she is in herself. It's because if she has walked blamelessly before the Lord, she has that right. So make a sacrifice. My servant Job will pray for you, and I will accept his prayers. You guys, I'm not accepting your prayers because there's a strong iniquity in your heart and you want to blame. So I'm going to accept his prayers, not your prayers. But let's look at verse 10. Let's look at verse 10. And the Lord restored the fortunes of Job when he prayed for his friends. And the Lord gave him twice as much as he had had before. Now look what happened. Job's life was restored after he prayed for his friends. So you know what this means? They built an altar and they burnt sacrifices before that altar and before the Lord. And Job was there with his boils, with skin peeling off his body, with his sores oozing, his pain, his body writhing in pain, his heart breaking because his children are gone. Job was involved with all of this. Hey guys, you were doing this and you stopped on us and you watched us, and I appreciate it. So thank you for tuning in. Thank you for spending some time with us. I pray that you enjoyed the service today. Let me take this opportunity to invite you out personally. We're located on the square in Sparta. Our service times are at 9 and 11 every Sunday morning. We'll meet you at the door with a hug. We'll meet you at the door with some coffee ready and some donuts if you want. And let me just take a real quick minute to invite you over to our Smithville campus. For those of you who can't drive over to Sparta, drive over to Smithville, 11 o'clock for now, at 614 Murphy Street in Smithville, Tennessee. So one of our campuses, Christ Point Church, we're real people, we're living real lives, and we're serving a real God. Welcome home.